Catherine, thanks for your kind introduction. Lovely. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all the attendees out there. Just excited having heard the large number of attendees in this meeting. And as just said, I'm going to talk about the energy enigma and the feedstock dilemma. Having said that, it's clear already almost in conclusion, I would say. So stating what are the real roadblocks ahead when we want to follow the pathway of net zero for green steel. It's all about energy and the feedstock. I'm going to start and jump directly into topic and summarize a bit what have happened over the past 2 years in the steel sector or general about decarbonization. So a large number of countries have over the past 2 years signed to a pledged net zero, and about 90% of the worldwide steel production is now covered by nations that have pledged to achieve net zero. However, just 20% of the steel producing capacity have provided a clear roadmap how they are going to achieve this this net zero. So there's still work ahead of us. And despite the steel sector, we're still confronted with about 36 gigaton of CO2 that is emitted in total. And if we are going to achieve the sustainable development pathway and limit the climate warming to 1.5 degrees C at the end, we will have to arrive at less than 10 gigaton of CO2 emitted. So many countries over the past years have implemented either a CO2 tax system or an ETS system. Well, on a different level, if we compare China and Europe from the cost of 1 ton of CO2, but however, it was a big driver and will continue to be a big driver for the decarbonization. Staying a bit with facts and figures of the steel industry, we have seen around 1.86 billion ton of steel being produced in 2019. About 70% it ran on still on fossil fuel, so coal or coke, and just the remaining part on natural gas or electric power. We're still emitting about 2 ton of CO2 for each ton of steel produced, which means overall about 3.7 gigaton of CO2 emitted by the steel sector. This reflects between 7 and 9% of the global CO2 emissions. Well, we all can expect, and it's good for the sector, that the growth will continue, mainly driven by the emerging markets. And our forecast from Primetals is that in 2050, we will see around 2.2 billion ton of steel being produced. The decarbonization, first of all, will require massive amount of green energy. And having said that, it will drive the growth of steel, basically. While solar energy and wind energy per kilowatt hour produced require more steel compared to any fossil-fired power plant. Well, on the political developments, we have seen starting in Europe in 2019, and then that's where the story started, the announcement of the European Green Deal, actually saying that we have committed to achieve minus 55% of CO2 emissions in 2030, versus the 1990 emissions, and becoming net zero latest in 2050. This comes along with a huge investment plan that should drive the economic growth, but also achieve the environmental targets behind. So we have seen also recently a quite steep price increase of the ETS price, and we have exceeded the 80 euro per ton of CO2 for Europe. What next? CBAM is the next milestone of the EU. Basically, it should ensure a fair trading of steel from any foreign steel into the European Union. The intention is also from the Commission to reduce the free allocation of ETS. First of all, with the shadow reporting until 25, but starting from 26, a continuous reduction of free allocations. This problem, this CBAM actually and ETS will not solve the export competitiveness of European steel to the outside. Well, if we look on the global situation, actually, and I'm going to focus on the outcome of the recent COP26 in Glasgow in November. Personally, I see it as a success, the outcome. So the Paris rulebook, first of all, has been completed. So now it covers 90% of the world nations that have committed to net zero, while it were just 30% in 2019. Another focus that has been defined is methane leakage. So 105 nations have pledged to focus the methane leakage issue. And finally, on coal, there was no agreement on a phase-out of coal, so this has not yet been signed, but at least it has been agreed to halt the funding by this year. Well, the steel sector will definitely see a phased approach when it comes to decarbonization. On the short term, we will see an optimization phase, and this is already ongoing. Optimization of technologies, energy efficiency, raw material efficiency. However, this is not enough to succeed with the sustainable development goals. This has a potential of 30% carbon reduction in total. On the contrary, if we look in the final phase of green steel, it will only work with carbon direct avoidance. Going into the hydrogen economy, direct reduction will play a key role in this transformation, and an increased deployment of CCUS technology while we continue to grow the renewable-powered EAFs, but in general, electrification. In the middle, we have the transition phase. The transition phase starts with the utilization of some hydrogen as available and feasible, and mix it with natural gas, but also looking into direct casting and rolling technologies. So again, energy efficiency and implementing the first electric arc furnaces into integrated mills. Well, let me start with the short-term options. Due to the time constraints, I'm just providing an overview. But we have developed quite a comprehensive landscape of multiple measures that can be implemented for all the individual process steps to decarbonize steel. And just starting here from the agglomeration as a first step, so sinter plant and pelletizing plant, there's a potential still of 25% to decarbonize. At the blast furnace, even more, up to 40% with the existing assets. And finally, on the basic oxygen furnace, again, up to 25% potential to decarbonize. Looking into mini mills, electric arc furnaces, Recently, we have seen, especially in China and Asia, quite a demand for new capacities in electric arc furnaces, and specifically in energy-efficient electric arc furnaces, like the EAF Quantum. The EAF Quantum is a shaft-based electric arc furnace, which utilizes the waste heat from the electric arc furnace and utilize the waste, the hot waste gases, to preheat the scrap that is fixed on the finger system. When preheated, finger system opens and feed the scrap into the hot heel to melt it down. Another point that electric arc furnaces is waste heat recovery. We believe finally this will become a mandatory step to recover the heat from the waste gases of the electric arc furnaces. Looking a bit more downstream only, coming back to the point of direct casting and rolling, I'd like to mention two technologies that play an even more important role. That's Arvedi ESP for the flat products and the Winlink technology for long products that has just recently been commissioned in Bangladesh. Both technologies have a potential to decarbonize by 40%, avoiding the cooling of slabs or billets and reheating in a reheating furnace. Let's have a look on the key drivers for net zero. And as mentioned, and this is also the title, on the raw material dilemma, the electrification, and also to carbon capture. So what is the starting point? Starting point, integrated mills, state of the art, that can achieve around 1.7 ton of CO2 per ton of crude steel when we consider the credits from the slag and the utilization of the top gas. Still, we can implement their CCUS, and further reduce then the carbon emissions up to 70%. If we switch to direct reduction, that has a potential to reduce by almost two-thirds, even still utilizing or starting with natural gas. This always considers that we utilize renewable energy to power the electric arc furnace. The lowest carbon emissions will always be if we utilize 100% recycled scrap into an electric arc furnace. We can achieve as low as 130 kilograms of CO2 per ton of steel. And finally, whenever hydrogen is available and also competitive, to switch from natural gas in the direct reduction to hydrogen plus an EAF powered with renewable energy that can achieve also carbon figures of less than 200 kilograms per ton. So how do we see the change of the technology routes over the next three decades? Today we see about 70% based on blast furnace and BOF, and only minor share is based on direct reduction plants, while we see a significant and growing share in EAF. If we look now in 2050, EAF-based technologies will significantly grow, plus a growth to 20% of DR plants, including EAF. So the share will exactly change from about 70% based on blast furnace, only around 33% based on blast furnace BOF in 2050, and the remaining part will use electric arc furnaces. Starting now to discuss the topic of raw material dilemma. This graph provides an overview of the total amount of iron ores utilized to produce steel today. And it clearly shows that the the major share of the iron ores are lower grade iron ores, so less than 65% iron contained. While these lower grade iron ores are utilized today in sinter plants and the blast furnace route, the high grade iron ores of more than 65% iron are used for the R grade pellets and direct reduction. As we will see less blast furnaces in the future, we have to think about how to utilize these lower grade iron ores in the future in DR technologies. And that's now moving from the left part, which is carbon-based technologies for iron making, blast furnace, Corex and Finex technologies, all three established in the market, and in the future to distinguish between the low-grade iron ore utilization in direct reduction plants, either shaft-based or fluidized bed-based, and due to the high amount of gangue, going into a smelting technology. And this is exactly where then Tim and as the next speaker will focus on. So I will leave it with that. For the high grade iron ore, it will still go as today into shaft-based direct reduction or fluidized bed-based reduction and directly into electric arc furnaces to produce steel directly. What is the forecast when it comes to direct reduction? And first of all, please focus on the right-hand picture here. It's a forecast provided by McKinsey recently, and it forecasts that we will see between 200 and 300 million tons of additional DR capacity till 2050. Considering that one module has around 2 million tons, we will see up to 150 new DR plants over the next three decades. This is significant. And these plants have to be fed with pellets or iron ore. And the forecast is in 2050 that 50% of these direct reduction plants will run on low-grade iron ore and the other 50% with high-grade iron ore. While today, only high-grade iron ore is utilized in direct reduction plants. So this will require additional pelletizing capacity for feeding these DR plants. Mentioning that not only Europe is moving quickly, but also Russia. Russia awarded Primetals and Midrex in the last year with two major direct reduction plants. Both of them producing will produce around 2.1 million tons of HBI, so the largest HBI plants in the world. They will still start with natural gas, but they are designed and engineered to switch over to hydrogen at any point when the hydrogen is available at scale. Talking about innovation. Primetals is developing a new technology called HyFO, hydrogen-based fine ore reduction. I talked a bit about fluidized bed technology and what are the main targets and the main benefits of the HyFO technology. First of all, the intention is to feed fine ore and ultra-fine ore directly without any pelletizing step. The reduction is done 100% based on hydrogen. And due to the small grain sizes, the kinetics is extraordinarily good. So the direct reduction runs on relatively low temperature, on low pressure, at excellent kinetics, and on highest yield. So that's the story behind that. What is the status? So we have engineered and commissioned that plant finally in the second quarter of last year, running the first campaigns, still optimizing the plant, but we will continue over the next 2 years to run that plant with a broad base of different iron ores. Again, the dilemma behind hydrogen-based direct reduction is that the huge amount of hydrogen is required. And just to provide a context here, To produce 1 million tons of DRI, this requires about 70,000 tons of hydrogen per year. And this reflects electrolysis capacity of up to 500 megawatts. The second raw material we have to talk about is scrap. Scrap is a wonderful recycling material because it can indefinitely be recycled. Unfortunately, it comes also with residual elements, mainly copper, phosphorus, plastics, sulfur. And this means that most of the scrap types come with more residuals than acceptable for high-end steel. While we see on the right-hand side in this graph that this is providing quite a growth in the forecast of the availability of scrap in the future. So today we see about 400 million tons of scrap in the market. In 2050, we will see around 900 million tons of scrap. However, the virgin and primary route will always remain the dominant route. So even we have 900 million tons of scrap, still we have to fill the gap to 2.2 million tons of steel in 2050 based on iron ore. What will happen in the scrap market? We clearly see the trend that the scrap will, the whole scrap yard will be automated. The main reason for that is to improve the quality. Scrap today is the only feed that is not well defined when it comes to the production process. So in the future, we expect that already at the incoming port, the scrap from the truck, the train, will be quality controlled, checked with the purchase specification. Confirmation of the scrap quality, of the scrap type, identifying unwanted and dangerous elements in there, removal of these dangerous parts, and finally then also an online analysis of these residual elements, remove these residual elements, and to provide a smart design scrap that has a clear defined quality, which is then piled. Stockyard provides also or will facilitate the purchasing of new scrap and the automatic feeding and charging to the BOF and EAF. Another dilemma I quickly want to mention is the location dilemma. It's pretty clear that we will see all these direct reduction plants in the market. We will see the electrification. The big question is where it's going to happen. One example highlighted here, Australia and Japan. Australia is the biggest iron ore exporter. Japan imports almost all the iron ore from Australia. Japan has extremely high energy prices. So question mark is where to place the direct reduction, in Japan or in Australia? And the same question mark we can put behind Europe and other regions in the world. Finally, I want to mention about carbon capture, storage and utilization. This is also an important pathway for the future. While we see today just 40 million tons of carbon captured from the industry, in 2050, the forecast is around 5.6 gigaton of capturing capacity. And almost 10% of that capacity, or 400 million tons, is forecasted to be utilized as well. If we break it down, and that's on the right-hand side to the iron and steel sector, it's expected that around 25% of the remaining CO2 emitted will be captured and partly utilized. Rheinmetall is a member, full member of Mitsubishi Heavy Industry Group, and MHI is the world market leader in carbon capture technology with their KMCDR technology, with capturing efficiency of up to 95%, covering 70% of the market share and having the biggest industrial carbon capture plant in the market that is stated here in the US of up to 5,000 tons of CO2 per day. One technology here at the end that's really worthwhile talking about, LanzaTech. LanzaTech is a biotech company based in the US, and Rheinmetall is a shareholder of this company. And the technology has been proven for BOF waste gas, but also for BF gas. And on the right-hand side, you see the ArcelorMittal Ghent project in Belgium that will be commissioned during this year and is utilizing 100,000 cubic meter per hour of blast furnace gas. So all the plants in operation now are focusing on CO fermentation, but in the future, the pathway is co-fermentation, CO, CO2 together with hydrogen, and finally, what is still in the pilot phase is the fermentation of pure CO2 plus hydrogen in chemical base products. That brings me to the end of my presentation. And I just want to conclude here. Green steel, what does it take? And have just a look on the right-hand side bottom figures. So we calculated if we would transfer the complete blast furnace-based iron making towards hydrogen-based direct reduction and electric arc furnace, it would take around 72 million tons of hydrogen, which reflects 500 gigawatt of electrolyzer capacity or around 4,000 terawatt hours of renewable power for each year. So that brings me to an end. Thanks for your kind attention and looking forward to your questions. Thank you.